In 1526, Babur began establishing the Mughal dynasty in India. Babur's general Mir Baqi built the Babri Masjid in his honor. Some Hindus believe he destroyed a temple to build Babri. They also believe that the temple marked Lord Ram's birthplace.
66 years ago, there was a flash of lightning at the Babri Masjid and Lord Ram himself appeared. This divine light determined who we vote for, why we vote for them, where we are as a country and the direction in which we are headed. Okay, so the flash of light wasn't a real thing, but a fable that became very popular in Ayodhya and the rest of the country. Pandit Abhiram Das was a 6-foot-tall wrestler with a quick temper. He led a raid of about 50 to 60 people along this very route and placed the idols of Ram inside the Babri Masjid, which he believed was a symbol of foreign oppression, built at the very same spot that Lord Ram was born.
The planning for this 3 a.m. raid was done at City Magistrate Gurudat Singh's house. His son recalled secret meetings that went on till late in the night.
मंदिर के निर्माण होना चाहिए इस बात को लेकर बैठक हुई थी चारों अधिकारी ये मन मना चुके थे कि भाई ये काम होना है
The FIR lodged the next morning states how thousands of people on hearing the rumor that Lord Ram had appeared at his birthplace barged into the mosque rendering it napak or impure They raised slogans and sang bhajans All this while, the district administration did not move a muscle.
चारों अधिकारी जानते थे चीज को कि बड़ी भीड़ होगी फिर भी जो स्टेप इन लोगों को लेना चाहिए था वो दिखाने के लिए उन्होंने जरूर लिया लेकिन उसमें थोड़ी छूट भी रही
The myth that a miracle had taken place inside Babri Masjid was further perpetrated when it became a matter of public record. On 23rd December 1949, Hawaldar Abdul Barkat had, in a statement to the police, said that about 2 o'clock, there was a flash of lightning, after which he saw that a beautiful child of about 4 or 5 years old was inside the Babri Masjid behind its locked gates.
Bhagwan prakat ho gaya. Ab Bhagwan ko prakat kara diya gaya hai, ek alag baat hoti hai. भगवान प्रकट हो गए एक अलग बात है
Despite Prime Minister Nehru's concerns, the incident was treated as a local communal incident which weren't entirely uncommon in this part of the country. In hindsight, placing the idols inside the Babri Masjid was the spark that lit the entire Ram Mandir movement and also shaped Indian politics as we know it today. A divine monkey or a prime minister looking to please everyone. Could both be equally responsible for turning the movement for a Ram temple into a deeply political one? But before the religious and the political crusade came the persecution.
Faizabad District Court. Judge K.M. Pandey saw a monkey holding a flag post here. People were offering it groundnuts and fruit. Judge Pandey thought it was strange that the monkey refused to eat. He then went into his chambers to hear a petition that wanted the locks of the Babri to be opened. Two officers who represented the Congress government, which was in power at the centre and the state, told the court that there would be no law and order situation if the locks were opened. This was curious because the Muslim community was bound to be unhappy if Hindus were given unrestricted access to a mosque, which remember had been desecrated by Pandit Abhiram Das and others some 3 decades ago. Judge Pandey ruled that Muslims were not going to be affected if the locks of the gates were opened and devotees were allowed to worship the idols placed inside. Heavens will not fall, he said, except they did. There was nationwide rioting in Delhi, Meerut, Hashimpura, Muradnagar, Maliana and even Anantnag in Kashmir where several temples were destroyed in retaliation for Babri. The rioting was a direct result of Judge K.M. Pandey's ruling which he later in his autobiography said was prompted by the divine monkey. I just saluted him and took him to be some divine power, he wrote. By the mid-1980s, it was impossible for the Indian public and our politicians to ignore the Ayodhya movement. February 19, 1981, Meenakshipuram, Tamil Nadu. 200 Dalit families converted to Islam. A collective spontaneous decision, it was prompted by years of oppression by the landed elite and rattled the keepers of Hindu morality.
The Dharam Sansad, or the religious parliament organized by the VHP, was the very first time that rebuilding a Ram temple was listed as an objective to preserve the Hindu Dharam. It was followed up by a bike rally, again organized by the VHP, from where car sevaks from across the country arrived in Ayodhya, came to the Sariyu River, took a dip and pledged to rebuild the temple.
While the VHP was on its Ayodhya mission, in Delhi, the Muslim clergy too hit the streets in protest. A 62-year-old woman, Shabano, won the right to alimony from the Supreme Court. Rajiv Gandhi then tried to calm the clergy down by passing a law that undermined the Supreme Court ruling on Shabano. The BJP accused Rajiv Gandhi of indulging in appeasement politics.
So a section of the Hindus were outraged at the outrage by a section of the Muslim clergy. So Rajiv Gandhi decided to pacify the Hindu lobby against accusations of indulging in appeasement politics.
And what better way than to facilitate the foundation laying ceremony of a Ram Mandir? In February 1989, the VHP announced it would conduct the Shilanyas for a Ram Mandir. As soon as they made the announcement, donations from across the world poured in.
Ram Shilas, or bricks, were collected from across Indian villages, wrapped in saffron cloth and then worshipped, brought here to Ayodhya to be part of the Shilanyas ceremony, which was blessed by the Rajiv Gandhi government.
The High Court had ordered that no construction could take place on this disputed land, but the VHP was ready to defy the court's orders. As a result, the atmosphere was communally charged up. The government had to intervene, and Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi deputed Union Home Minister Bhuta Singh to travel to Ayodhya and try and pacify the VHP. Up until now, the Congress had appeared to be opposed to the Shilanyas. But on 8 November 1989, just 2 days before the proposed Shilanyas, the State Advocate General said that the High Court order could be interpreted to allow the Shilanyas. Now, this was legally debatable, but the Congress suddenly appeared to be in favour of the VHP. The upcoming election could have had something to do with this change of heart. Despite having 404 Member of Parliament in a 533-seat strong parliament, the Congress was fighting the election with its back against the wall.
The Rajiv Gandhi government at the time was under attack on three fronts. The Beaufort scam was unravelling, the political situation in Kashmir and Punjab was getting out of control,
and VP Singh was on the verge of quitting the Congress cabinet and forming the Jan Morcha.
The Shilanyas movement has evolved a great deal from the mid-1980s. From just a collection of red bricks from across Indian villages, it is now a collective of artisans who continue to work in the hope that a Ram temple will be built. But it is the Shilanyas which was possible because of the Rajiv Gandhi government, which marked the complete politicization of the Ram Mandir movement.
Soon after coming to power, Prime Minister VP Singh accepted the controversial Mandal Commission report. For the first time, 27% was given to lower caste Hindus at all levels of government service. Rajiv Goswami, a 19-year-old Delhi student, set himself on fire in protest. The Mandal Commission report divided students across the country. Upper caste Hindu and minority students hit the streets in protest. The BJP was in a quandary. It could not support Mandal because it discriminated against their upper caste Hindu vote base. The BJP needed to change the conversation from caste and quota to religion and Ram. And so the decision was taken to launch a Rath Yatra from Somnath to Ayodhya. BJP President L.K. Advani would travel in an air-conditioned Toyota bus turned chariot. Thousands of people followed his yatra across Indian towns and villages to hear Advani talk about Ram's birthplace, his temple, and how the government stood in its way. But with the yatra, the BJP was defying the very government it was part of. Its partner in power, the Janata Dal, wanted to stop Advani from conducting car seva in Ayodhya. On 23rd October 1990, first-time Chief Minister Lalu Prasad Yadav, then part of the Janata Dal, arrested Advani in Samastipur, Bihar, and kept him in custody for a week. The BJP naturally withdrew its support to the VP Singh government. The country was left politically unstable and communally divided.
The VHP was determined to perform car seva on the scheduled date of 30th October 1990 with or without Advani, who remember had been arrested in Bihar just a week earlier. The Mulayam Singh Yadav government, on the other hand, was inclined towards not letting that happen. They had blocked all road and rail routes coming into Ayodhya, which further angered the car sevaks. The stage was set for a confrontation. A bus belonging to the provincial armed constabulary was stationed right around here. Thousands of car sevaks reached the area. Some of them got onto the bus and drove it right through the cordons that had been put in place on this road that leads to the Hanuman Gadi and ultimately to the disputed land.
The car sevaks were pushed out of the disputed property only when the ITBP opened fire. Two car sevaks were killed. 2 days later, they congregated at Hanuman Gadi, angrier, more determined to start the construction of a Ram Mandir.
Uma Bharti was leading 5,000 car sevaks from this road that leads to Ayodhya. However, she courted arrest at the Kotwali just about 20 metres down the road before the firing took place. From this lane behind me, VHP's Ashok Singhal was leading another set of 5,000 car sevaks. And from this road that leads to Faizabad, VHP's Swami Vamdev was also leading about 5,000 car sevaks. So essentially, by noon, this little crossing had about 15,000 car sevaks wanting to break through the barrier that leads to the disputed land.
The car sevaks adopted a unique strategy. Women and old men went right up front. They sat on the ground and would touch the policemen's feet. Indian tradition prohibits an older person to touch a younger one's feet. The policemen would instinctively step back and the crowd would push forward. But the drama did not last long. The police started firing at the car sevaks without warning. According to the Mulayam Singh Yadav government, 15 people were killed.
At the end of the day, angry car sevaks refused to conduct the final rites of those who died that day and demanded to march once again at 6 a.m. Swami Vamdev tried his best to calm them down but couldn't. It is then that Vinay Katiyar came to the limelight for the very first time. In a speech that he gave to the car sevaks, he issued a 24-hour ultimatum to the Mulayam Singh Yadav government to open up all the road and rail blockades. Mulayam Singh Yadav government responded by opening up the blockades and allowing car sevaks to pray to Ram Lalla's idols inside the disputed structure in batches.
On October 30th, the VHP organized a Dharam Sansad asking car sevaks to converge on Ayodhya on December 6th. At 6 a.m. on a wintry morning, journalists and car sevaks began arriving at the disputed site. By 10 a.m., sadhus, sons and BJP leaders like Advani and Murli Manohar Joshi had also reached.
As per the official itinerary, the car seva was to begin at 11 in the morning and the plan was to simply take water and sand from the Sariu River and clean the platform that had been constructed near the disputed site. At 12 o'clock, a long, loud whistle was heard and while the sadhus and sons continued to clean the platform, the younger car sevaks were seen moving towards the disputed structure. They broke open the barbed wire, they used ropes to climb up the disputed structure and then hammers to ultimately break down the entire structure.
Appeals by BJP and RSS leaders to the car sevaks to retreat fell on deaf ears.
Prime Minister Narasimha Rao had stationed about 80 companies of the CRPF in Ayodhya. Quick reaction teams had conducted mock drills on bikes. But on December 6th, none of them could be deployed because of the sheer number of car sevaks who were involved. As soon as the car sevaks reached the Sanctum Sanctorum, the idol of Ram was taken away by paramilitary forces to another location. It is at this point that the attack on journalists and cameramen started.
The car sevaks did not want any proof of the demolition to remain. At 2 o'clock, the first dome collapsed. Some 25 car sevaks who were buried under were pulled out and rushed to the hospital in press vehicles. At 3:30, the second dome gave way. And by 5 p.m., the entire structure had been razed to the ground and the debris leveled. In the accompanying frenzy, some mosques and homes of Muslims in Ayodhya were also burned down.
In the evening, when journalists went back to the disputed site, say that they saw car sevaks laying bricks and cement and creating a staircase that would lead to the spot where the idols would once again be placed. A tent was constructed and prayers were conducted.
Thank you.